Okay. It will work. I'm going to put a little bit down. Maybe this way. Okay. So what we will do, we will finish with this refresh of eigenvalue stuff and then go to the main lecture, gradient descent, Newton, Gauss-Newton. Okay. What remains us to remember that this is eigenvalue decomposition, which we already wrote. But if I put all eigenvalues as diagonal matrix and all eigenvalue vectors as a matrix capital B, which column, each particular eigenvector is a column of B, you can check that I can this equality write in matrix form. Why can I do it? Because multiply matrix by a matrix with columns, it's the same like multiply H by first column and put result in the first column, multiply H by second and so on. So this will be give me HV, and you can check that this is V multiplied by lambda by diagonal matrix. And I can do one more thing. And I say that assume that eigenvectors are linearly independent, and there are n eigenvalues, eigenvectors the same as the dimension of my space. So V is invertible matrix, and we can multiply by V inverse from the right hand side. And this will give us nice formula. H is, so I might multiply by A, V inverse, so I get just identity here. V lambda V inverse. And then I can ask a question, what is trace of H? Trace of H. I'm going to put this parenthesis. What is trace? It's sum of diagonal elements. I need to hear some voice yes to be sure that
yeah.
The identification is working. Thank you very much. So this is trace of V lambda V inverse. Can I simplify this expression?
Yes. Single property of the trace.
Because I know that under trace the cyclic change of order. So I can move V inverse here, yes? And V inverse V will cancel, will give identity matrix. And this give me a very nice formula. This is trace of lambda. It means very nice thing. Let me separate this. Very nice thing that sum of diagonal entries of H is sum of lambda I. So it's I have already one equation. And what regarding determinant of H? Determinant. Maybe I have stronger pen. Maybe just a second. Determinant of V lambda V inverse. And you may remember the determinant of product of matrices is product of determinants. Yes?
Yes.
Yes. Okay, so this is determinant of V, determinant of lambda, and determinant of V inverse. And you may also know the determinant of inverse matrix is 1 over determinant of original matrix.
Yes.
It was in the, who doesn't remember, it was in the first lecture, refresh of linear algebra. So that's why I can cancel those. Hat is one is 1/2, and I remain with determinant of lambda. Very nice thing. So determinant of my matrix, it's a product of lambda I, yes? Determinant of diagonal matrix is just product of its elements. Product of lambda I. So in this way, if I see my matrix H, I can have trace of lambda, I mean sum of lambda I, and I can have product of lambda I. And this is an alternative way. And I will give you, I don't know, 3 more minutes with this matrix H. Try to develop alternative way to, so we have those two properties. Yes, finally we derived them. So we know lambda 1 plus lambda 2 is equal something. And lambda 1 multiplied by lambda 2 is equals something. And you can again derive what are lambda 1 and lambda 2 in alternative way. Please do it. It will take 3 minutes, I hope. And raise your hand. Huh?
Can I ask a question in the time?
Yes. Regarding this stuff, because regarding other stuff, we will talk later.
It regards the convergence rate.
Okay. I'm with you.
So why is the convergence rate, is the SEN calculated in the optimal point? Why in the optimal point? And what happens when there are several optimal points?
You asked in the chat, yes? So we say, all we study is in our course is local convergence. Local convergence may mean when you are around the optimal point, or global convergence if your function is convex. It has only, for example, if it's strongly convex, it has only one minimum. So if you have different, if you have several local minima, then each local minimum may have its own Hessian, and it will have its own rate of convergence.
But if you...
Okay. Michael.
Yes?
Let him finish him.
I'm not sure that it's healthy that we are talking while other people are working. It's not good.
We can wait.
Let's finish with this and then...
I just wanted to ask if the solution has anything to do with Vieta?
I don't remember letters. Tell me in words.
With Vieta, it's to do with polynomials.
Can they cashew?
You mean this stuff?
Yes. Yeah.
Let discuss it.
Okay.
Okay, does anybody finish? Did anybody finish? Not yet. Okay. Let's wait a little bit more. I resumed recording. Okay.
So we're using Vieta's formulas, we can get these two equations, lambda 1 multiplied by lambda 2 equals to that determinant shell H equals to 400. And the sum of the eigenvalues is 1002. from the first equation, we can get that lambda 1 is equal to 400, or lambda 2 equal to 400 divided by lambda 1.
Mm-hmm.
We use that in the second equation. We get lambda 1 plus 400 divided by lambda 1 equals to 1002. Yeah. And solving the quadratic equation, we get...
And just a second. Let's pay attention. This quadratic equation that you showed us, is it the same as the characteristic polynomial? It is the same equation as we had in the first part of the class.
Yes, it was.
Okay, very good, very good. Thank you very much, Magid. Okay, you can stop sharing. Okay. So. And then I will share my presentation. I will share my screen. Share screen. Where is this one? Okay. Now we are back to our lecture. And we say in the lecture, do you see well my sharing?
Yes.
Okay. So, and okay, in the lecture, we told that there is a steepest descent method, which has this nice graphical illustration. We go by gradient. So this is level lines, for example, of my function, and gradient is orthogonal to level line. We minimize and go again with gradient and so on. The method is zigzagging, and convergence rate has this expression. By the way, I am not sure. It seems that here should be a constant of 2 or even 4. Yes. If you compute this for the case when lambda mean is much smaller than lambda max, yes?
Michael, it shouldn't be squared. We showed in the tutorial it shouldn't be squared.
Okay, this is, thank you for your question. It really depends.
Sure. What's your question?
Wow, Google. I should put it away. Just a second. Google is hearing me and disturbing our lecture. Okay,
so participating.
So the there are two possible definition of convergence rate. How function value is coming close to the optimal, and how norm of x, norm of discrepancy, distance between x and x optimal. And pay attention that our function, we have quadratic function, yes? And close to solution, it's like square distance. That's why this measure in the objective function is square with respect to measure in the x. So you can use both of them, but be careful. Always remember, you are talking about convergence of the objective function, which is quadratic locally, yes?
Just a second.
Or distance for the solution. If you will take square root here, you will not have square here.
Michael, we didn't hear you for the last 30 seconds. You were... Okay,
sorry. Do you hear me now?
Yeah, we hear you now.
Okay, my internet connection.
Now it's okay. Now we hear you. Good action.
Let me come back. Because the objective function is quadratic, the convergence rate in objective function will be squared with respect to convergence rate in distance to the solution. Because objective function itself is proportional to the square of distance to the solution. That's why if we measure it in the objective function, we get square here. And this approximate equality, I would say it may have even 4 here Yes? You can think what will be approximately this expression for the case when lambda mean divided by lambda max is some small number. I leave it for your own consideration, but approximately.
Can you repeat your explanation? It, for me at least, it wasn't clear about the squared.
So, okay. You think about function of one variable, yes? Y is x squared, yes?
Okay.
And I ask you if I got to the in distance, say 10 to the minus 2, if my distance between x and x optimal is 10 to the minus 2, what will be difference between function and optimal function value? It will be 10 to the minus 4. It will be square. Yes, this is my objective function.
Okay.
And that's why if I define convergence rate in terms of objective function, it will be like square of convergence rate if I would define it in distance, in terms of distance. So you should be careful whether you are talking about convergence in objective function or convergence in distance. There will be exactly the square relation.
But in the objective function, it depends on the function, right?
But it depends on the function. But you should remember that locally, our function is very well approximated by quadratic function. It has first and second derivative around solution. If you are talking about smooth function, so locally our functions are all functions. If you consider function. For example, minus cosine x around solution, and we'll plot it in the interval from minus 0, 0, 1 to plus 0, 0, 1, and you will discover that you cannot distinguish it from the parabola in the same interval. Okay, let's go ahead.
Michal, can I ask a small follow-up question on the?
Yes.
So if we take the objective function, you mentioned that we will get the convergent rate squared of that. But if our criteria is not about the objective function, it is about the difference in gradients.
No. It's two criteria, which each of them has. Its own right to exist. You should always ask, you're asking about convergence in objective function or convergence in distance?
Either one or both.
Okay, but they are different, add up to this square. Okay.
Thanks. Thank you, Michael.
Okay. Please.
Michal, may I share just for a second?
We should advance. Let's leave more questions for our free discussion after the end. Otherwise, we will get stuck with this small stuff. I remind you that we have reception hours after the end of the lecture, and you are welcome to participate. Okay, let's continue. And now we come to the Newton method, which we say, if I have a function and I have a quadratic approximation of this function around the current point, then I go to the minimum of this quadratic approximation. And in multidimensional case, it is quadratic approximation is expressed via Taylor expansion, where G is gradient in the current point, H is Hessian, and D is displacement from our point xk. And we compute gradient of this approximation with respect to displacement. and get to very famous Newton formula, Newton equation, that Hessian multiplied by displacement is minus gradient. So to get displacement, we need to solve this equation. Any question at this point? Okay. Just raise your voice. That can we continue?
Yes.
Thank you very much. So this is the Newton method, and we learn Newton method with line search, and there are other methods which called. I always have this problem in Zoom with showing whiteboard in parallel. Showing whiteboard in parallel to the slides. I will stop for a second my recording. Where is my recording? Wow. I lose it. Ah, here. I will pause. Pause share. I lose control of my recording. Okay. Do I have recording?
The recording is open now.
Is open, but I lose control of recording. Pause. Maybe it's here.
Maybe if you stop
pause the recording. Yes, assume recording, and we will leave it for online. I will try to write with large letters. So there is one more topic which is called trust region. Newton. So we learn line search method. So we computed Newton direction and go in direction of line search. But there is another very important family. If somebody works practically with Newton method, then in the book Nocidal and Dryad, he will find another class of methods, which is called trust region. And when you solve practical problem, I strongly recommend, especially if your problem is not convex, then try this family of methods as well. Okay, and let's continue.
Can I ask a question?
Yes.
About the alpha initial in the video, you say it's supposed to be one.
Yes, it's very important. Thank you for this question. If I go to the previous slide, I use quadratic approximation of my function, and to go with the step size one, it means to go to the minimum of my quadratic approximation. And especially when I am close to solution, my quadratic approximation become very good. So it's very good, first of all, to check alpha, which corresponds to the minimum of quadratic approximation. Then my method will converge very fast. If I will start with alpha, which corresponds to larger value, I will lose this optimality. And then by backtracking line search, by crude line search, I will jump back. I reduce my alpha strongly, and then I will miss this very good point. So that's why it's really important to start your alpha in Newton method with alpha equal one.
But actually, if you miss it, you will find it in the next iteration, won't you?
Yes, but your iteration, your current iteration, will be much less efficient than comparing to the iteration when you go exactly to the minimum of quadratic.
But Okay, and are there any other cases which alpha initial shouldn't be one, which you
we will learn quasi-Newton methods. In Newton-related methods, it should be one. In other methods, it's maybe different policy. Okay. And we say that very important property of Newton method is when you come close to solution and your function is smooth and nice, you achieve a quadratic convergence. So kind of you get to some accuracy, say 10 to the minus 2, and then this exponent will be doubled at every iteration. 2, then 10 to the minus 4, then 10 to the minus 8, then 10 to the minus 16. And if you will plot those numbers on logarithmic scale, you will get this down-looking. It's even not parabola, it's even faster decreasing than parabola. And this is a very important criterion to see whether your implementation is good. If you did everything right in your Newton implementation, you will get this nice parabola. If you have some mistakes, for example, even if you started with alpha, which is not one, you will not get this nice plot. And this is the second answer to your question. Okay, let's continue. And okay, in the lecture we told that if your Hessian is positive definite, that Newton method guarantees to give you the same direction. And if you have non-convex function and your Hessian is not positive definite, then in those line search methods we use the modification of Hessian. It's in some case we look implicitly for close to our Hessian matrix, which is positive definite, and this is achieved by
Michael. Just one question, Michael, yes. About this. When you say non-convex function, you mean non-strictly convex? Because Newton is
even non-strictly convex. You're right. You're right. Because even if function is convex but not strictly, the Hessian will be degenerate, and then solution of Newton system also may point you to infinity. Yes, this solution okay, but, HG. The solution of your inverse will not exist, yes? So you are in troubles. You need really positive definite matrix here.
Michael, but we can use modified Newton method even for strictly non-convex functions?
Yes.
Yes?
There is no notion strictly non-convex. There is notion
strictly
of
concave.
Convex, no, concave, there is no, for strictly concave function, I should do large pictures because I have my video in very small screen. Concave function has this look, yes? This function has no minimum. When we talk about non-convex function, we are talking about this kind of function. Yes?
Okay.
Which may have a convex part and non-convex part and so on. And we don't want to get stuck in non-convex part. If we are here, we still want to go in direction, for example, some close related local minimum. And this modification will help us.
Okay, thanks.
Okay. So we get, first of all, how do we get modification in two steps. First of all, we say what is Cholesky factorization. Actually, what we write here, sometimes it's called LDL factorization, because classical Cholesky factorization is without this diagonal part. But for optimization, for practice, it's very good to use this kind of factorization. Sometimes people also this call Cholesky factorization. And we don't go into details, but you can always find it any source We only say that this is good, very good, stable procedure, and it takes about n cubed divided by 6 operations. And when we have this factorization, we can solve our Newton system efficiently by forward and the diagonal and back substitution. I refer you to the lecture how it is done technically. And this takes about n squared divided by 2 operation, those two basic steps, forward and back substitution. Okay, and then we say that there is a modified Cholesky factorization, which does clever thing. If our matrix A is not positive definite, it implicitly it still finds some factorization. It finds some lower diagonal matrix, lower triangular matrix L, and diagonal matrix D with non-negative entries. Yes, and one can show that this expression is always positive definite. Maybe I should leave it for your home exercise. For any matrix L and non-negative D, or say positive diagonal matrix, this is a positive semi-definite, at least, matrix. So modified Cholesky factorization finds this factorization in the way that our original matrix A plus some correction, implicit correction E, which we don't use anywhere, is a positive definite, so it has this factorization. And the Newton method is modified Newton method, is we substitute our Hessian, which is not positive definite, with this expression, which is guaranteed to be a positive definite. And we solve this corresponding Newton, modified Newton system in those three steps, forward, diagonal, and backward substitution, and get our Newton steps. And this is what you will do in your homework. Yes, any question at this point?
Yeah, Michael, yeah. Why is that correct?
Yes.
Why is adding the E matrix to make it PD or PSD is the correct, I don't know, notion to get the same goal?
This algorithm finds a kind of, it asks a question, what is small modification of E to have this positive definite? We get to the goal only in the sense that if we solve this system with any positive definite matrix, our direction is guaranteed to be direction of descent. Inner product of our direction with gradient will be negative.
But you are solving it for a different.
I should get back to a couple of slides. We say that for any matrix H, yes?
Yes.
If you found D as a product of some inverse matrix with gradient, yes? And we know that H is positive definite, we are guaranteed, it is in the lecture, that this expression is positive definite, mean inner product of gradient with D is negative. So we only guarantee that our direction is direction of descent. We have no guarantees that this is be very efficient, very good direction. Just a second. That this direction will be very efficient, very good. But you can intuitively think that if my correction is small, then my direction is close to Newton direction. So,
okay,
so it's only by hand waving. It's only proof of convergence, no proof how fast it goes.
But the last statement you just said, it depends on A. I mean, if E is, I don't know, maybe the eigenvalues difference or something like that. I mean, because
yes, you are right. Nothing about efficiency. Only the claim that this direction will be direction of descent. And practically, it works very good.
Okay.
Practically, it works very good. This is one of methods of choice, to use Newton method with modified Cholesky factorization. Okay.
Thank you.
Let's go ahead. And then there was a Newton method for solving a system of equations in other video. And we told that those are like brothers, Newton method for minimization and Newton method for solving equation. So we say, assume we have a vector function f of x. So f has many function inside, many entries. So, and we want to solve this equation. We can expand it as a linear model. And you watched 3 minutes about Jacobian. What is Jacobian of my function? If I have such a general function. I have such a general function.
We differentiate it with respect to every element of the vector x.
And yes, Jacobian. I have to stop sharing. Because otherwise recording will not be good. How do I stop share? I stop share and I say. F, just a second, take another pen. F of x plus dx, this is vector function, is f of x, f of x plus Jacobian matrix multiplied by dx. And what is if my f is a vector column f1 of x, say fm of x, f1, f2, and so on, then Jacobian, I can sometimes put it Jacobian with index f, is just such a matrix where gradient of gradient transpose of first function will be first row of this matrix, df1 dx1 df1 dx2 and so on. And the last will be DFM. DFM DX1. DFM DXM. Okay. So, and this is linear expansion of my function. And I wrote in the lecture, it's a gradient of f1. Where should I put transpose? Let's put it transpose here. Yes, and gradient of f2, transpose, and so on. This is equivalent. Okay. And now I will switch to the presentation. You will not see my whiteboard large. Or actually, you will, but in the recording, it will not be large. Okay. And we are get to the back to the presentation. So we have this linear expansion of my function around solution. Around current point. And instead of saying that f of x we want equate to zero, we equate to zero linear model of our function. So we are staying at the point xk. So linear expansion is in this way. Its value at xk plus Jacobian multiplied by displacement. And we equate this linear expansion to zero. We solve this equation. Jacobian multiplied by d is equal to minus f. Yes, it's a linear system of equations, which gives us next point. Any question about this?
The Jacobian is actually the gradient then?
Jacobian is a matrix. Pay attention to the Jacobian. This is vector function.
Yeah, but it's gradient of each row, like each value.
Yes. First row of Jacobian matrix, it's gradient of first component of F1. First row of Jacobian matrix is gradient of F1. The second is gradient, but transpose. Our convention is gradients are columns. By the way, it's convention for optimization. In other areas of physics and mathematics, you will find gradient rows. Be ready for this. It's only in our course, gradients are columns. Yes, I'm with you.
So the linear expansion is a Tyler expansion, actually, with the notion of a multivariate function.
You can think about this, yes.
Okay.
You can think about this. Okay. And then here is a graphical illustration of Newton method. So we are staying in the original function. We do linear approximation, linear expansion, equate it to zero, find where this linear expansion meets the point where f is zero. And this is our function x1. Again, we compute linear expansion, and this is x2. And you see that we get some converging process. And how it is connected to optimization in very simple way, if you want to minimize function and we are around, we are close to some local minimum or global minimum of convex function, then minimizing f is the same as equate gradient to zero. And solve Newton and run Newton system for Newton method for system of equations. This is system of equations. And the only thing which completes our picture that actually Hessian of our function, original function of this function f, is Jacobian of gradient. If gradient is nonlinear function of x, one can find, it's not difficult, that Hessian is Jacobian of gradient. And in this way, this method and the method for minimization will coincide. The only advantage we have in minimization method, we can do line search with natural function, which in one-dimensional optimization, we will try to minimize f. When you solve equations, you need some artificial additional functions. You don't enter into this area, but it's an important thing. To think how somehow we control our step size to make algorithm converging globally, it's more challenging in equations than in usual minimization. Okay, and then we go to least squares. Okay. Yes. Somebody should tell yes.
Yes.
Okay, thank you very much. Then I know that communication is working. And one last very important example, when there is no exact solution, f of x is zero, but maybe approximate. So we want to minimize some of discrepancies, how far every component of x is from zero. And this gives us a rise to Gauss-Newton method, which says following, it's not exactly Newton, it's like close in spirit to Newton, but a little bit different. That we use a linear expansion of our function, inner function, which is inside of this squared norm. And at every iteration, instead of minimizing the square norm of the original function, we minimize square norm of its linear expansion, which is given with Jacobian. And it's solving linear least square problems. And there are special methods, efficient and stable numerical methods for solving linear least square problems. And if somebody doesn't know those methods, he just writes down gradient of this expression, which is written here, and equates it to zero, and gives this explicit solution. But it's naive way. It's good to do it sometimes, but mostly recommended to use established method for linear least squares to solve this problem, but not to go directly, because here you have a product of Jacobian matrix which is self, and products, when you multiply matrices, the condition number squares, the eigenvalues are squared, and the numerical stability of this expression is not so good when condition number is very large. Any question, any comment at this point?
Where is the alpha of the line search? I was meaning to ask this also in the previous slide.
I would say in simple way, all related to line search, the ideas may be like those that you have from Newton method. There is another very important related method, which I didn't mention in this lecture, but it is mentioned in the old lecture. This is called Levenberg Marquardt. Levenberg I always do mistakes in this. Levenberg Marquardt method for least squares. And idea of this method that you to your objective function, you add some regularization term, you also penalize some two norm of x with some small coefficient, and this implicitly controls your step size. Unfortunately, we cannot do it in the framework of our course. Wow. Do you hear me? Hello?
Yeah, there was a lag in the connection.
Yes, I get the message that the internet is not stable. So we Levenberg Marquardt, we don't study in our course, but it's extremely important for least square problems. And even with neural networks, if you train some small new neural network, this method may be a method of choice. So pay attention that Gauss-Newton and Levenberg-Marquardt are closely related, and in practice, this second method, it's a little bit more sophisticated. That's why it is not in our course, but in practice, you may want to use it for even for training small new neural networks, say if you have a neural network up to 1,000 weights, this may be by far the fastest methods among all existing. Okay. Again, any question, any comment? We will answer some questions now, and then I invite you as usually to remain for free conversation part of our meeting. Any question now?
Michael, what I asked you before, is it possible now or only in the reception?
Try to ask, and we will see.
I'll just do a screen share, because the problem is that what you said about the convergence ratio does not correspond to what we learned in the tutorial, because in the tutorial it's not squared.
It's not squared because in the tutorial it's distance from the solution. Yes.
I'll show you. Okay.
No. Let me say it shortly. It's briefly. In tutorial, it's distance between x and x optimal, and that's why there is no square.
In tutorial, it's distance. It's the ratio between the distances.
Yes.
Of the k plus one step divided by k steps.
Distance from xk to x optimal, comparing to distance xk plus one to x optimal. Yes, I will write it down here.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you.
Just a second. Is there any question to this slide? Because I will, otherwise I will stop screen sharing. To keep recording. No questions. So I stop sharing and get back to my whiteboard. So we have this x k plus one minus x star, say Euclidean norm, divided by x k minus x star. And other criterion I remind was xf k plus one, yes, k plus one minus f star. Where can you start? Okay, f k minus f star. Okay, so if this, say for example, is c1. And this is C2. Usually C1. Usually C2. It's about C1 squared. Okay.
Michael, I understood now. I understood what you're saying. It's the okay.
But it's an important question because there are two conventions.
Can you continue?
Okay. Any other question or comment, and I will see.
Thank you very much.
Michael, can you continue the explanation?
The explanation with slides?
No. What you just did.
This one?
Yes. Yeah, can you explain it again? Why we have this difference?
Because think about f of x. Is just x squared. I will just give you an example, yes? And x star is zero, yes? We have this f.
Yes.
F of x. Do you agree? And of course, f star is also zero. Yes.
Yes.
Do you agree that this expression is square of this expression?
The norm?
It's in one dimension, it will be absolute value, yes?
Yes, yes, okay.
So, okay, so then you understand it. Those two relations.
So this is true in the quadratic form.
But I should stress again, smooth functions, which we minimize, locally they are quadratic.
Someone has his microphone on.
Please, yeah, mute my microphone if you talk on the camera. Okay. Okay, now we smoothly move to the free conversation. And we have 17 participants.
I can hear you. This is true for the quadratic form, right?
Yes, yes.
So this works. This is like a squared because of the quadratic form, but other equations which we might want to investigate, which are not which are convex but not quadratic, won't be true.
I invite you to write down where can I I will remove this. We already. Assume f of x is minus cosinus x. Okay. What is f prime of x? Just tell me.
Sinus x.
What is double prime of x?
Minus cosinus x.
Minus cosinus x. And assume that I am staying in the origin, yes?
Okay, yeah.
X equals zero. So.
You owe the function twice.
F of x. Okay, is minus one, okay. And f double prime, yes.
The modulus cosinus as minus.
F double prime, I even skip f prime. Okay, f prime is zero, yes?
Yeah, the second derivative is plus cosinus x.
Okay, the Blair minus gamma.
Plus, yes, thank you. And f double prime is one, yes. And let me do even one more thing. One minus cosinus, yes. Then I zero, yes. And
yes.
If you have MATLAB, and you will plot the graph of this function from the interval minus 0, 1 to 0, 1, you will discover that and also plot parabola x square, you will discover that you will not be able to distinguish between those two plots. It means that locally if our function is twice differentiable, locally we can always think about our function as quadratic.
Okay. Yeah, I understand. Okay.
Anybody try to do it? I know students are very fast. Maybe anybody anybody do this? Please do us a favor. Do in MATLAB or whatever tool you like the plot of this function and the plot of x square. Just a second. X square or half? Just a second, half of x squared. What is second derivative of x squared? It's two, yes? So we need half of x squared. It's this and the comparison is half of x squared, yes? Because we want to have the same set. Can anybody do us a favor to do this plot in MATLAB or whatever you like and share? No?
Any volunteer?
Just a second. X squared and y minus cosinus?
No, half of x squared. And 1 minus cosinus x. In the interval from minus 0, 1 to 0, 1.
It usually takes a few minutes just to open MATLAB.
But did anybody do it?
Yes, I can share screen if you want.
Okay. Yeah, please share your screen.
Okay, just a second.
Who is this? Tell your name, because I don't see.
Barak.
Huh? Yeah.
Barak.
Okay, and do we see your MATLAB window? We don't see. We don't see figure. You can share screen instead of sharing window.
Okay.
But this is one plot, or those are two, and they coincide.
Yes.
That's why let's expand this in interval from minus half to half. Just expand the interval of the plot.
Okay.
To see the difference, yes?
And by, yeah.
And of course, the step size may be much larger. 0, 1 is enough.
Okay.
It's good. Now we see that they are extremely close, but they diverge, I don't know, from 0, 3, we start seeing something different, yes? Okay, so this is good illustration to see that locally functions are quadratic.
Locally, the minimum is equivalent.
Yes, so and if you ask the rate of convergence, you can think about how quadratic function will converge. Okay.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you for sharing. Just a second. Yes. Any other question, comment?
Okay, יש לי שאלה, אנחנו בשעת קבלה עכשיו.
Just a second. Let's, the reception hours. Let's discuss mathematical questions and maybe more close to end. Let's do the following. First of all, do you have any questions, comments regarding the lecture?
Yes, I didn't understand well the extended the ways that we have for to the problems, like it's not convex. I didn't really understand what you did there.
You mean with modified Shulevsky?
Yes.
Okay, let's put we will return to it. Other questions.
I also have a question about the modified Cholesky.
Please mute your microphone. Somebody is talking of participants. Please mute your microphone. Yes, I'm with you.
Okay, so I have a question about the modified Cholesky.
Again, the same. Other questions? We will come to it. I just want to put a right order in order to minimize jumps in our conversations.
Yeah, I also have a question about the Gauss-Newton for the least squares.
Okay. Gauss-Newton. More questions? Okay. Let's jump to Monika Chilesky because it's more
one more question, please.
Yes.
About the convergent conditions for convergence.
Conditions for, are they from the lectures?
Well, in the lecture there is the condition on the objective function, but we also have from the tutorial a condition on the distance, and maybe we can think of
you mean not condition, expression for convergence rate.
Well, I mean the by condition I mean when we implement the algorithm we always use the threshold. We say that when a certain condition holds,
yes,
the process.
No. Yes.
Okay.
It always difficult. I would propose you to consult this question with the teaching assistant because it always problematic. When you just testing your method, it's healthy when you know the actual solution. Yes. For testing the method, then you stop just when you are in distance from the actual solution, in certain distance or certain function with your curves. If you don't know, then you measure your progress. You may measure your progress in iterations, and this is a technical question. I don't want to intervene. There are many delicate possible approaches. I don't want to intervene what assistant talked to you. So let's go to these two questions, and then we will see. So I will get back to my presentation. Share. Okay. I am thinking Gauss-Newton. Okay. Chilesky is important. Modified Chilesky factorization. So what is the question? Let's talk about this.
The way we choose E will determine if we go in a descent or an ascent.
I would say we don't choose E. Mm-hmm. We take matrix A,
yes,
and put it into black box, which does modified Chilesky factorization. How it works, it's a little bit out of scope of our course. You can just try to read it. I hope that maybe Nocidal and Wright book, which is on our list, considers this thing.
Yeah.
But what you do practically? You run modified Chilesky factorization of matrix A, yes?
Yes?
And then you compute Newton step with this. Pay attention that you don't use E anywhere. E is needed just to write here equality, yes? That our factorization is not actually factorization of A, but of some corrected matrix, which is positive definite.
Okay.
After correction.
I need to be careful because if I will use the modified Chilesky factorization,
yes,
the matrix A should have some properties. I mean, at least one of its eigenvectors should be with a positive eigenvalue. So.
Just a second, let me think.
Okay. Okay.
So you did this you got this message from the code of modified Chilesky? Where from did you take this requirement?
This is an observation I'm trying to make.
I'm not sure that this is right observation.
Can you explain?
If I have negative definite matrix with all negative eigenvalues, yes?
Yes.
And I add identity matrix, I always can choose such large identity multiplied by some scalar. Maybe I should stop sharing. Stop share. And let's go to our screen. You see my whiteboard, yes?
Yes, I can see it.
Okay. Let's consider a matrix. Some matrix A, which has a lambda A, its eigenvalue, the diagonal matrix, say minus one and minus two, and my matrix E is identity multiplied by 2.1 multiplied by identity. Mean it's 2.1 and 2.1. Let me remove this, sorry.
Okay.
And here are zeros, yes?
Yes.
And I ask question, I even can denote B is equal to A plus B. First of all, I ask, what is lambda B? Can I write it as lambda A? Plus 2.1 multiplied by identity. Do you know such nice property? I even will write here explicitly 2.1. multiplied by identity. You know, if I add the identity matrix with some multiplier, then all eigenvalues, this amount will be added to every eigenvalue?
Yes, it's a very, very useful
application. It's very useful property, and it's very easy to prove it. So, and of course, what will be lambda B? In our case, lambda B. Let's write it down. Please tell me.
It's 1.1. Let's do minus 1 plus 2.1. It's 1.1.
1.1. And here?
It's 0.1.
0.1. And as you see, I have this positive definite matrix B, which always have this LDL factorization, yes?
Yes.
So even for negative definite matrix A, modified Cholesky works.
This is a great example, and I would like to put it in the context of a quadratic problem that I'm trying to find a minimum for. The quadratic problem would be X transpose times A times X. And by times, I mean the matrix.
Yes, but if you will have, it's a good question. Thank you very much. We are discussing really important stuff. So if I have a problem, X transpose AX, maybe even half, and to have the same question. How will it look? It will be such kind of function, yes?
Exactly.
In multi-dimension. It doesn't have minimum at all, it has only maximum.
Yeah.
So, modified Newton from every point will look for descending. It will go to infinity.
This is exactly the reason why I wanted to make this the previous observation that.
But yes. I may have a nonlinear function which will look like this at some area, yes, and in some other area it will have minimum. Okay, and assume I start here. I start moving here. Here my Hessian was negative definite, yes, all negative eigenvalues. But I decrease my function and get into other area where Hessian is different. It will be positive definite if the function here is strongly convex. It has a unique minimum. Then here the Hessian may be positive definite. Not sure. Maybe some degenerative cases like in one dimensional x to the power of 4. Yes, x to the power of 4.
Yes.
May have 0 second derivative, but still have a strict local minimum. But in any case, we will escape this area. But modified Newton will work for this function. It will escape this area of local maximum. Go, and come. The only thing you should not start where your gradient is zero. If you started somewhere the gradient is not zero, you guarantee that at every iteration you will decrease your objective function. You never will come here. Why? Because we do method with line search. Then at every iteration we are guaranteed to have descent direction, and we do line search and we decrease our objective function. We never will move to this maximum. We will move in direction of other minimum.
It's a perfect explanation.
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for good questions. It's important. We put all this on the recording. Okay. And there was any other question regarding this stuff?
I have a question for something else. We did linearization of in some parts. It's not affecting the results when we do linearization, because if you linearize things, it might have, you lose data there.
I'm not sure that I... Yeah, did anybody understand? I want collective brain to help me. Did anybody understand the question?
Only partially. I would like Tidan to please repeat it.
Yeah, I'll find the slides. It's just a second.
You want to share a slide? Okay, please share a slide with us. We are in free conversation. How many people remains? 4 people. But this part will be available for other people who want to watch it afterwards. Okay. Do we record? Yes, we do. I can pause the recording. Okay. Okay, you have my slides. Good. In which tool do you show them now? Hello?
Idan, I think you are muted. Idan?
Yeah, I use my iPad. Just using my iPad.
Okay, good.
Do you hear me now?
Yes, we do. You should say your question is about Gauss-Newton. Okay. Yes. Okay, go ahead.
We try to minimize sum of squares.
Please use your pointer.
I have a pointer?
You should.
I don't. I have.
Okay. If you have problems, just go ahead.
No, it's okay. I'll just use this thing.
Okay.
We try to minimize the sum of squares.
Yes.
Okay. But here we use a linear expression. It doesn't add up because sum of squares is it isn't linear. It's part of have higher penalty about something that is not.
You're right. We use linear expansion of the inner part, yes, and then yes. External part we keep quadratic as it is. And you are right, and this is very important question, that our method is not the same as running usual Newton method on this objective function. Okay, this was your question. I understand, right?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay. Can you stop your sharing? And okay, so you can stop your sharing. Okay, this is very important question. I'm not sure that I have. Maybe I will show my slides.
You are stuck in my. The picture is frozen.
My picture is frozen.
Oh, it's okay. Now it's okay.
Yeah,
it's okay now.
If the communication is bad, you should immediately tell me.
I sound lag.
Now is okay?
Now it's okay for a while.
Wow. I need to switch to maybe other communication. Okay. Gauss-Newton. Pay attention that here, what is written here, actually it's scalar function of x, all this expression together. And one can write Newton method for minimization of this function. And it will be not the same as Gauss-Newton, which we derived here. But interestingly, if we come to the area when our f of x is small, mean least square solution is good, and we have an optimal point, f is very close to zero, one will discover that Hessian of this entire function will have two parts, and one of the parts will be multiplied by the values of f, and will be moved out, will be small. And remaining part of Hessian will lead us exactly to the same direction as Gauss-Newton works. I wanted even to put it as exercise.
Can you repeat
our
it?
Class, I didn't class, but we, okay, let me explain once again on the whiteboard.
Michael, I didn't hear for the last 30 seconds because the internet reception.
And all others also didn't hear? Please, anybody else, give your feedback with voice.
Yes. Actually, I can hear, although I didn't fully understand.
But the voice was okay, or it was interrupted?
The voice was okay.
Okay, so then the problem was not on my side. It's important to know about the communication. Let me show you something. Let me define some other function. For example, h of x is 1/2 of this expression f. Is it good to use h? Let me think. Okay, that would be phi of x of f of x square. So f is a vector function. But this is usual scalar function, yes? I should stop my sharing in order to keep screen recording. Stop share. Okay. So f is a vector function, and all this expression which we use in Gauss-Newton, I will define as a phi of x. And I can write Hessian phi of x. And one will discover, and I will I can write even Newton method, usual Newton method, inverse by gradient. This is the usual Newton direction. And what one can show that if f and this is d Newton. Yes? And one can show that if f of x becomes small, goes to zero, then d Newton becomes very close to d Gauss-Newton. And this I want to keep as a small exercise, but unfortunately we ran out of time. But this issue exists. So Newton method for this problem is different from Gauss-Newton. It becomes close to it if we are able to achieve area when f is very small. By the way, not for all least squares problem, it is possible. Sometimes you minimize your discrepancy, but it still remains large, even in the minimum. And the third remark, despite that those two directions are not the same when our discrepancy is large, quite often Gauss-Newton is still very good direction. It may be quite often even better than Newton direction. And pay attention that the method doesn't rely on the convexity of f of x. So you don't need no positive definiteness of Hessian of components of f of x when working with Gauss-Newton. Only Jacobian of f is used, only gradients of components of f are used. It's on this hand waving. If you want more insight, you can find on YouTube on a list, on the list which is referred in the beginning of the homepage, my old lecture on Gauss-Newton. My lecture from, I don't know, maybe 15 years ago. Or maybe a little bit less, and this issue is touched in the old lecture.
Okay.
Please. Any other question or comment?
יש לי שאלות, אבל לא על ההרצאה שלהם.
יש לי עוד שאלה על ההרצאה של היום.
You want my slideshow?
הסלט
כבר. אתה מדבר אליי או אלי דן?
Just a second. If anybody talking on telephone, please mute or speak somebody else. Ken, what is the question?
I want to see the intuition about the why we multiply by diagonal math. It wasn't diagonal. It was like a rectangular matrix. Yeah, what is exactly we lose data? Didn't
just a second. Which method you are talking about?
Here, this slide.
Huh?
This slide.
Ah. So by coincidence, I came to the right place.
Yeah.
Okay. So we are talking about solution of symmetric positive definite system. Pay attention. Symmetric positive definite.
Yeah.
With modified Cholesky. No rectangular matrices here.
So what
matrices are square.
Here, this thing.
Yeah, so it's square matrix with a lower diagonal, lower triangular elements, and everything above diagonal is zero. Yes. So what is your question?
So it's supposed to be L. It's supposed to be L or what?
L, yes.
So if it's positive diagonal, I can find such a that is D L. It's I know it's supposed to be משולשית עליונה.
You can talk Hebrew and we will translate. Okay. It's okay.
בקיצור, אז לכל A מוגדרת חיובית, אני יכול L תהיה משולשית עליונה.
Yeah, yes, the answer is yes. For every A positive definite, this decomposition exists with a positive D. Yes, the answer is yes.
Okay.
So okay. Thank you. Yeah, any other question, comment?
Yeah, I have a comment about the Cholesky factorization.
Yes.
That I know it to be with two matrices, M times M transpose.
Yes, you mean without diagonal. Yes, you are completely right. And classically, it's like L multiplied by L transpose. And this quite often is called LDL factorization. But sometimes it's called also as Cholesky. It's a question of terminology. You are right. But for optimization purposes, this representation is more stable. It's more practical than representation without D. This decomposition is more practical from numerical stability point of view. Yes.
Okay.
Any other question, comment?
כן, יש לי שאלות, אבל לא על ההרצאה.
כן, you can talk in Hebrew and I will translate it. אפשר בעברית, כן.
סבבה. סתם כזה יותר מהיר.
כן, אפשר בעברית.
אחלה. כמה דברים. דבר ראשון, ממה שהבנתי ממך, אנחנו מחשבים את הקצב, אוקיי, יש קצב התכנסות? ויש יחס התכנסות.
It's terminology, it's the same.
אוקיי, תודה.
Actually, the standard term, it's not ratio, but rate. Rate is the more standard term. Sometimes somebody
makes the... אז על הקצב התכנסות שאנחנו מדברים על המרחק, על ההפרש בין ה-X עם הנורמה, אז ראינו חסם על הדבר הזה.
You want to say that in tutorial there was a theoretical development of actually the formula which is rather close to the formula which we use, just a second. Let's put rather close to this formula, yes? Maybe okay, without square.
Maybe with
some coefficients. Sometimes there are some development that may have two at some point and so on. Yes? Without square, because we already discussed, I'm sorry, we discussed. We had a long discussion. This is about objective function and those was about closeness in the norm of
X.
Did you were part of this? I'm afraid you could be
awake.
On this discussion, we already had it.
אני יודע, שמעתי את הדיון הזה.
אוקיי.
סבבה. אוקיי, אז מה שרציתי להגיד, אנחנו מצאנו איזשהו חסם על הבטא, על ה, סליחה, על, ה, על המרחק בין ה-X'ים, זאת אומרת, כן. על היחס הזה של ה-X'ים, מצאנו...
איך הוא נראה? הוא משמעותי אחר, הוא קרוב ל...
זה דומה, הוא די דומה.
The expression is close to this formula, maybe without square, maybe two at some point, yes?
כן.
Yeah, okay. Yeah. It's good that there are a little bit different developments, and it's very good to know them. One may be simpler for you, one more difficult. It's good. It's good that, that you have them.
Okay, סבבה. אז מה שאני רוצה להבין רגע, אנחנו אמרנו ש, ממה שאני רואה כאן, שההפרש בין האיטרציה הבאה לאופטימלי, קטן שם בין מאיזשהו C של האיטרציה הנוכחית פחות האופטימלי.
Yes.
סבבה. עכשיו, ה-C הזה, אנחנו הבאנו אותו מתוך, מתוך מה שגילינו על ה-X'ים, זאת אומרת, מתוך מה שגילינו על ה-X'ים?
Yes, it's the same. It's only square is different, because the question is whether somebody develops convergence rate in variables, in norm of distance, or in function value, so usually the difference is related to this square.
Okay.
Or maybe half at some point, coefficient 2 at some point.
Okay, בסדר גמור, ועשינו כאן איזשהו שוויון כזה של בערך, של 1 מינוס למדה מינוס וגרם דמר.
זה טעות, נדמה לי שזה טעות, פה צריך להיות משהו כמו 4, כן?
אוקיי, אבל זה נכון, כאילו הקירוב הזה נכון כשלמדה מקס מאוד גדול מלמדה מין?
נכון, נכון.
כמה זה אומר?
נדמה לי שצריך להיות 4. אתם מסכימים איתי?
לא יודע, צריך לפתח את
זה. זה טור טיילור בעצם של ה...
כן, כן.
אז חצי, צריך פקטור חצי. אוקיי.
יש משהו שמגיע מ... ריבוע, ויש משהו שמגיע, שיש גם פה יש שינוי, כן?
מה זאת אומרת זה טור טיילור, אבל איפה הטור טיילור של איזה משתנה ובאיזה נקודה?
המשתנה זה למדה מין חלקי למדה מקס.
טור טיילור ביחס, טיילור אקספנשן ביחס לזיס...
זה המשתנה.
You can call this epsilon, כן?
אוקיי, סבבה, אוקיי, זה האפסילון המשתנה, ומה הנקודה שאנחנו מחשבים, אפס?
שהוא אפס.
הוא טיילור מחושב בנקודה מסוימת.
מסביב לאפס.
מסביב לאפס.
כן.
אוקיי.
אפסילון שווה אפס.
אז רגע, שנייה, צריך לפתח את זה.
I will leave you for you, and you can share it. You are so fast that you can do it immediately, yes?
אוקיי, סבבה, זה פחות קריטי. אז זה נכון כשלמדה מקס מאוד גדול מלמדה מין. סבבה. עוד משהו שרציתי לדעת, אמרת מקודם, כאילו דיברת על זה מקודם, שצריך לבחור את אלפא שווה לאחד בהתחלה.
נכון.
למקרה שאם אנחנו באמת קרובים ל... אם הפונקציה, אנחנו באזור שהפונקציה נראית באמת כמו פרבולה, אז עבור אלפא שווה לאחד אנחנו ניפול בדיוק על המינימום, ובגלל זה אמרת את זה. כי למה לא לקחת אלפא קטנה יותר בעצם? יכול להתחיל עם אלפא חצי.
So the question whether you can start with step size smaller than one. If you will start with small step size smaller than one, you will not get to the minimum as fast as we can with the step size equal one.
הבנתי. אתה אומר שאלפא 1 מביא אותך בדיוק לנקודה, ברגע שאתה דומה לזה.
It will exactly in the minimum if your function is quadratic, and it is very good approximated by quadratic, like we saw in the example of cosinus, yes?
כן.
1 minus cosinus, you exactly will get, you, not exactly, but with very large accuracy, you will get to the solution for you. אוקיי.
Okay. טוב, נראה לי שזהו.
אוקיי.
זהו, פשוט...
Yes, yes.
אתה יודע מה, אני רק רוצה לחדד משהו.
כן.
שוב, בתרגול ראינו את הקצב התכנסות, שזה מרחק בין ה-X'ים, ופה אנחנו מגדירים איזשהו C אחר, שכאילו הגדרנו אותו, את ה-C הזה, להיות האמנה הזאת. נכון, אמנה הזאת. נכון? ואמרנו זה מתקיים. אמרנו, ההפרש בין ה-F'ים האלה, קטן שווה מ-C כפול הפרש. פשוט אמרנו שזה מתקיים, נכון?
נכון.
יפה. עכשיו, אוקיי, עכשיו, למה זה משהו מציק לי? כי בתרגול ראינו רק חסם, לא ראינו למה הוא שווה, ופה אתה אומר לי ממש...
No. Here, pay attention. Here,
אוקיי, החסם הוא
על... Also like bound. Yeah, the actual convergence may be much faster. I will open your a secret that if you have two-dimensional quadratic function, some people studied it and showed that it goes much faster than this ratio. But in general, this is like this ratio. This is a bound. It's not exact value of...
Okay, אז פה גילינו איזשהו חסם, וגם שם גילינו איזשהו חסם, ואנחנו אומרים, אוקיי, יש קשר ביניהם, בגלל ש...
וזה אותו דבר. You will discover that this is the same. up to square, maybe coefficient 2.
אוקיי, בסדר גמור, תודה.
אוקיי, בבקשה, בבקשה. You're welcome. אוקיי, אז סיימנו. We finished, yes?
תודה רבה, מיכאל.
תודה רבה על השתתפות.
זה נושא מאוד מעניין, ונתראה בשבוע הבא.
שבוע טוב. ביי ביי.